In this video, we are going to study about the orbit. The orbit or the pair of bony cavity which contains the eyeball and their associated muscles, nerves, blood vessels and lymphatics and a part of lacrimal apparatus and a quantity of fat. Each orbit is a four-sided pyramid with an apex directed behind at the optic canal. And the base is represented by the orbital margin. So this is the base and this is the apex. When you see the medial wall of both orbits, so these are the medial wall, they lie parallel to each other and they are about 2.5 centimeters apart. So the distance between the two medial wall is 2.5 centimeters apart. Separated by the nasal cavity. The lateral wall, they slope backwards and medially. So this is the lateral wall which slopes backwards and medially and meet each other at a right angle. So both sides, they form a right angle when they meet. The orbital margin at the base measure about 35 millimeter in height. So the height of the orbital margin is 35 millimeter and the breadth is 40 millimeters. So this is the breadth which forms the 40 millimeters. The orbital index is calculated by the maximal orbital height by the maximal orbital breadth into 100. The eyeball occupies the anterior two-thirds of the orbital cavity and it projects beyond the orbital margin so that when a sharp needle is introduced from the lateral margin to the bridge of the nose, it will traverse behind the lens. However, the projecting supraorbital margin, the bridge of the nose, prevents a flat surface from striking the eyeball. Next, we'll see the boundaries of the orbit. The orbit presents a roof, a medial wall, floor, and a lateral wall. Now, we'll see the roof of the orbit. The roof is formed by two bones, the orbital plate of the frontal bone in front and lesser wing of the sphenoid bone behind. The anterolateral part of the roof presents a fossa for the lodgement of the orbital part of the lacrimal gland. A trochlear notch or spine at the anteromedial angle of the roof gives attachment to the pulley for the superior oblique muscle of the eyeball. The optic canal is situated at the extreme posterior part of the roof between the two roots of the lesser wing and the body of the sphenoid bone. The optic canal transmits the optic nerve invested by the sheath derived from the three meninges and ophthalmic artery. The apex of the orbit is represented for the purpose of the measurement by the center of the bony bridge that intervenes between the optic canal and the superior orbital fissure. Now we'll see the floor of the orbit. The floor is formed by three bones. Orbital surface of the body of the maxilla. Then you have the zygomatic bone anterolaterally. And then you have the orbital process of the palatine bone posteromedially. The floor of the orbit presents the infraorbital groove and the canal which transmits the infraorbital nerves and the vessels from the inferior orbital fissure. So this is the inferior orbital fissure. From here the infraorbital vessels and the nerve passes through the infraorbital groove, then canal, and emerges out through the infraorbital foramen. Just a lateral to the opening of the nasolacrimal canal, the anteromedial angle of the floor gives origin to the inferior oblique muscle. Now we'll see the lateral wall. The lateral wall, it is the strong wall and transmits the force of mastication from the molar teeth upward. The lateral wall is formed by two bones, the zygomatic bone in front and the orbital surface of the greater wing of the sphenoid bone behind. The lateral wall presents a small foramina for the passage of the zygomaticofacial and the zygomaticotemporal nerves. Just behind the lateral margin of the orbit, slightly below the frontozygomatic suture. So this is the frontozygomatic suture. So below the frontozygomatic suture, you have a palpable elevation that is known as the Whitknoll's tubercle. So this gives attachment to four structures: the lateral palpebral ligament, then you have the check ligament of lateral rectus muscle, then you have the suspensory ligament of eyeball, then you have the levator palpebrae superioris muscle. Between the posterior part of the lateral wall and the roof of the orbit exists a retort-shaped gap that is known as the superior orbital fissure, which communicates with the middle cranial fossa. The fissure is bounded above by the lesser wing of the sphenoid and below by the greater wing of the sphenoid bone, and it is wider medial end by the body of the sphenoid bone. Close to the medial end, the lower border of the fissure is marked by a tubercle which gives attachment to the lateral part of the common tendinous ring. The medial end of the fissure represents the bulb of the retort, and the tubercle at the lower border represents its neck. The tendinous ring provides the common origin of the four recti muscles of the eyeball and extends across the fissure to gain attachment to the undersurface of the lesser wing around the upper and the medial margins of the optic foramen. So this is the tendinous ring. So this tendinous ring divides the superior orbital fissure into three compartments: a lateral compartment, an intermediate compartment, and a medial compartment. The structure passing through the lateral compartment are the superior ophthalmic vein, the lacrimal nerve, the frontal nerve, and the trochlear nerve. Along with these four structures, you have the recurrent meningeal branch of the lacrimal artery. Through the intermediate compartment, you have the upper and the lower divisions of the oculomotor nerve, the nasociliary nerve between the two divisions, and the abducens nerve, the sixth cranial nerve, which lies below and lateral to the lower division of the oculomotor nerve. The inferomedial compartment transmits the inferior ophthalmic vein. Outside the tendinous ring, the orbital surface of the lesser wing gives origin to the levator palpebrae superioris muscle and more medially to the superior oblique muscle. At the junction of the posterior part of the lateral wall and the floor of the orbit lies the inferior orbital fissure. So this inferior orbital fissure communicates the orbit with the infratemporal and the pterygopalatine fossae. The fissure is bounded below and medially by the maxilla and then laterally by the greater wing of the sphenoid bone, and the lateral end of the fissure is usually formed the zygomatic bone. The medial ends of both the superior orbital fissure and the inferior orbital fissure meet to form a V-shaped extensive fissure. The inferior fissure transmits the infraorbital vessels and the nerve, the zygomatic nerve, the orbital branch of the pterygopalatine ganglion, and the communication between the inferior ophthalmic vein and the pterygoid venous plexuses. Now we'll see the medial wall. The medial wall is the thinnest wall and extends from the anterior lacrimal crest on the frontal process of the maxilla to the optic foramen. The medial wall is formed by four bones from before backwards. You have the frontal process of the maxilla, then you have the lacrimal bone, then it is formed by the orbital plate of the ethmoid bone, and finally behind by the body of the sphenoid bone. The lacrimal bone presents a vertical ridge that is known as the posterior lacrimal crest. The lacrimal fossa intervenes between the anterior lacrimal crest and the posterior lacrimal crest. It lodges the lacrimal sac, which is continuous below with the nasolacrimal duct. The anterior and the posterior ethmoidal foramina lie at the junction of medial wall and the roof of the orbit. The anterior and the posterior ethmoidal foramina transmits the vessels and the nerves of the same name to the anterior cranial fossa. Next we'll see the orbital margin. It forms the four-sided curved margin and it is contributed by frontal, zygomatic and the maxilla in nearly equal third. The supraorbital margin is formed by the frontal bone, presents a notch or foramen at the junction of lateral two-third and medial one-third. So this is the supraorbital notch. Sometimes it may present as a foramen. It transmits the supraorbital vessels and the nerves. Traced medially, the upper margin is continuous with the posterior lacrimal crest. The infraorbital margin is formed by the zygomatic bone. So this is the zygomatic bone and the maxilla in equal half, and traced medially, this infraorbital margin becomes continuous with the anterior lacrimal crest. The orbital septum, derived from the orbital periosteum, is attached to the orbital margin and the posterior lacrimal crest. When you see the relations above, it is related to the anterior cranial fossa and the part of frontal air sinuses. And below it is related to the maxillary air sinus, and medially it is related to the ethmoidal and the sphenoidal sinuses, and laterally it is related to the temporal fossa and the middle cranial fossa. The contents of the orbit of the eyeball, then you have the muscles of the orbit, then you have the fascia bulbi, the nerves are, you have the optic nerve, then you have the oculomotor nerve, then you have the trochlear nerve, then you have the abducer nerve and the branches of the ophthalmic nerve. And then you have the lacrimal gland, a part of the lacrimal gland also present in the orbit. Here you can see the ciliary ganglion and the optic nerve clearly. So these are the contents of the orbit. So the next contents are the ophthalmic artery. So this is the ophthalmic artery and the superior and the inferior ophthalmic vein. And along with that, you have the orbital fat.